North Korea tests another round of missiles despite facing more than a year of tough international sanctions. Seoul and Washington move forward with the deployment of the missile defense system THAAD, while Beijing takes aggressive steps in retaliation. All this right ahead. Hello and welcome to News Inside. I'm An Jianghyun. Let's meet our panelists. Professor Shin Sang-yeop from Pyongyang University Graduate School of International Studies joins us once again. And Dr. Bong Young-sik from Yonsei University Institute for North Korean Studies is with us as well. North Korea test-fired more ballistic missiles on Monday, just about 3 weeks after its previous provocation. It's now been a little over a year since the international community slapped the regime with some of the heaviest sanctions to date. But has that yielded any progress? Take a look.
On March 6th, North Korea test-fired a number of missiles toward the East Sea. A total of four missiles traveled eastward into the ocean, with three of them landing in Japan's exclusive economic zone. The launch came less than a month after Pyongyang test-fired its intermediate-range ballistic missile Pukuksong-2. Many speculate it was an act of protest against the Seoul-Washington joint military drills that began this month. The North had already warned it would take strong action against the annual drills.
미 공화국의 자주권이 행사되는 영역에 단 한 점의 불꽃이라도 날린다면 즉시 무자비한 군사적 대응이 개시될 것이다.
In response to the military provocation, South Korea's acting president, Prime Minister Hwang Kyo-an, convened a National Security Council meeting and ordered heightened military readiness. Meanwhile, it's been over a year since the UN Security Council adopted Resolution 2270 in response to North Korea's fourth nuclear test. It included tight measures on trade and finance and were hailed the strongest sanctions against the country thus far. This prompted the international community to step up pressure on Pyongyang's nuclear development, and countries like the US, Japan, and the EU rolled out unilateral sanctions. Seoul also introduced strong measures calling on South Koreans to refrain from visiting North Korean facilities overseas. But the North has so far remained defiant. We look at where things currently stand.
Dr. Bong, we had expected North Korea to carry out another provocation sooner or later. I guess it chose sooner rather than later. Is there a significance in the timing of the latest tests?
Well, I have no intention to advocate North Korea's horrific behavior. We should be condemned in the strongest terms. But at the same time, I don't think there's any element of surprise that we have to accept. Because North Korea had already announced last November when high-ranked officials of foreign ministry met, former, U.S. officials who used to be in charge of North Korean affairs and nuclear proliferation in Geneva. And Ms. Choi Sung-hee announced that we would take some time to learn about Trump administration. But once the U.S. and South Korea would begin the annual joint military exercise, then we will make things rough and tough. So it's basically North Korean regime following through what it had promised in a very ugly fashion.
Do you think Kim Jong-nam's assassination factored into this?
I don't think so. No. This is by and large a response to the beginning of the joint military exercise, expressing its anger and opposition.
Now, the missiles launched from Dongcheongni on the west coast of North Korea towards Japanese waters. Why do you think it has fired four missiles in one go?
Well, the missile launch put more pressure on new USA government, I mean Trump administration. They just tried to identify how they will counter Kim Jong-un's weapon development. So by giving them more pressure, they want to make the atmosphere, which can be more favorable for them, to discuss about the their policies and to develop the relations or dialogue with the USA. And lastly, there was a report that one meeting between North Korea and USA was scheduled to be held in USA, but it was canceled because after the assassination of Kim Jong-nam, the USA government denied to issue the visa to North Korean participants. So it can be, we can say there are several reasons, but definitely because of those reasons, North Korea launched the missiles this time.
Mm. Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe strongly protested the missile test, calling them a new level of threat.
Missile was 1000発を 使用し, そのうち 3発が 我が国の排他的経済水域内に着弾したものとみられます。これは北朝鮮が新たな段階の脅威であることを明確に示すものであります。
Some say, though, that it is a rather convenient distraction for Abe.
This is highly sophisticated and well-orchestrated missile test by North Korean regime, because this is not ICBM. So this is a little too short for the international community to condemn for North Korea launching another ICBM in violation of the UN Security Council resolution. And North Korean military, control the arc in a very high degree, so that although the average range of these missiles surpass the 1,000 kilometers, but North Korea demonstrated its ability to control the range and the precision, at the same time, the mobility of the missiles at its own will. So basically, it's sending the message to South Korea, Japan, and the United States that deployment of a missile defense system in South Korea and Japan will not be effective. So you better deal with us in our own terms. Mm. And Japan's government, although alarmed, but at the same time must be tempted to use this as an excuse to increase its defense spending, probably for the first time in modern history to break out the self-imposed cap of 1% of the GDP. Abe administration would use this as a justification to convert Japan as a quote-unquote normal country.
State, right. Well, there's a growing concern about a new arms race taking place in the region. Dr. Bong just mentioned Japan increased its military budget. We also know that the US and China have beefed up their budgets as well.
So if I give you the figure, the budget, for this year, military budget, the USA increased 10% over the last year. So they assigned $603 billion for the military budget this year. And the China, how about China? China also decided to increase the military budget by 7%. Well, in the for the first time in the Chinese history, they assigned more than 1 trillion yuan. Well, Japan, well, because of the reasons we discussed so far, well, they assigned 5,125,000,000,000 yen, which is really huge amount, isn't it? And so there must be some races among the three major countries in the region.
Now, according to the New York Times, President Donald Trump's security deputies have discussed the possibility of bringing back tactical nuclear weapons to South Korea to counter the North Korean threat. Do you see that happening?
It may happen, but I'm really suspicious of its effectiveness. Think about it. If we introduce, once again, like in 1980s, U.S. tactical nuclear weapons to South Korea soil, then the purpose is to, scare North Korean regime enough that it would not, dare, continuously, launch missile and nuclear tests. Or if ever, God forbid, North Korea military uses nuclear weapons to attack South Korea, then there will be sufficient retaliation in kind with tactical nuclear weapons so that North Korea regime will not dare to launch first a nuclear strike. All these scenarios based on the assumption that North Korean leadership is a rational actor, right? Because victory in war will be meaningless if both sides will be totally destroyed and devastated by exchange of nuclear weapons. So before they talk about tough measures, including surgical strike and including assassination of top leadership, or elimination of the top leadership in North Korea. They have to come back to the drawing board, and if their policy prescriptions are based upon reasonable understanding of correct reality. Otherwise, South Korea will be the victim, innocent victim, in sea of fire between the U.S. and North Korea. So as long as there are numerous U.S. citizens and U.S. GIs, you know, taking just their normal lives in South Korea, then North Korea will not be scared because the words do not match with their touted policy.
So the talk of tactical nukes is just one of the options that they're mulling over in their effort to deal with North Korea. It only shows
how desperate the United States government is in terms of lack of any viable options to deal with nuclear North Korea.
Mm-hmm. Okay. North Korea's provocations are obviously with the U.S. in mind. How do you think the Trump administration will respond to all this?
Well, what is certain, actually, USA government is put every options available to them on table. According to the report made by New York Times, Trump administration is considering policy which was seriously considered, reviewed by the former President Obama. Obama government tried to conduct the electronic and the cyber strikes against the North Korean the nuclear programs. And the another one is the economic sanctions. In 2005, the Obama government imposed economic sanctions against North Korea. At the time, the North Korea could not use $25 million assets outside North Korea. So because of that, they had a really hard time.
So all options are on the table for now. So all these measures that the international community has taken to try and curb North Korea's weapons program, including supposedly the toughest sanctions to date by the UN, as well as some other countries, how effective would you say they've been?
When was the first time that the world began to deal with something called a nuclear crisis of North Korea? 1993, right? And we have passed at least four UN Security Council resolutions. Every time UN Security Council passed their resolution against North Korea for its violation of a missile test and the nuclear test, every resolution was touted as the toughest ever. This time the sanction will bite. This time it will hurt North Korea where it hurts.
So they didn't
what happened?
Work at all.
It failed to stop the clock of North Korea's nuclear missile program. Mm. So think about it, analogously speaking, I detected 20 years ago a symptom that may suggest a cancer growing inside my body. So I visited my doctor and got the prescription of medicine called economic sanction. And the doctor promised it will work. It's the toughest ever. And failed again and again and again, and the cancer kept on growing. Isn't it time for me to see another doctor or question the effectiveness of the medicine that I've been taking for 20 years?
A surgeon?
A surgeon, maybe, tougher measures, because a cancer must be more resilient and malignant than I originally expected. Or some kind of combination of prescription that I've been taking and something else?
Uh-huh.
Okay. It's time to be creative, thinking outside the box.
Right.
Yes, and obviously China's role is crucial in all this. Now, Beijing says it is playing its part in pressuring the North, but do we believe it?
No, I don't think so. I mean, Chinese government pretend to play some role in an effort to change North Korean regime. They even stopped imports of the coal from the North Korea. But by using a sick way, they help North Korean regime evade economic sanctions imposed by the United Nations. Well, for example, when we look at the export volume and import volume from North Korea to China in 2016, even increased. North Korean exports to China increased by 7%, according to Voice of America. How about imports volume? North Korea's imports from the mainland China reached $3.1 billion, which was the increase by 8.3% over the previous year. So certainly these figures tells what? Definitely economic relations between two countries has been strengthened despite of the economic sanctions. Yeah. And lastly, I talked about some special way used by the Chinese government to help the North Korean regime was consignment production. It means that where Chinese government consigns the production of the some goods to the North Korean companies and North Korean government. For example, there is a one shoes makers in Shinuiju, which is one of the city nearby the border between China and the North Korea. They produce the workers of the Chinese soldiers. And then secondly, which is really concerned more, that is Chinese government even consign the production of the machineries which required some state-of-the-art technologies to North Korean companies. In fact, they do not have those kind of state-of-the-art technologies, which means that there must be some cooperations between two countries in transferring or in helping North Korea to get the state-of-the-art technologies from China. Mm. So it can be a good opportunity for North Korea to get access to the global market more easily or relatively shorter time than expectation. So on a mid or long-term basis, maybe this is one of the way used by Chinese government to help North Korea.
So, and on top of the help that it's been receiving from China illicitly, a UN report issued late last month unveiled some new evasion techniques that North Korea has been using to flout sanctions. And increasing sophistication and greater ingenuity were some of the phrases used to describe these tactics.
Right, you don't want to underestimate the capability of North Korean regime to evade international pressure and sanctions. One of the favored techniques used by North Korean regime to avoid the pressure was to, you know, do financial transactions via, you know, Chinese companies by sharing the ownership of the Chinese companies or, you know, setting up, you know, company that are not supposed to be officially a financial institution, but actually the arms of the, you know, North Korean banks, mm-hmm. Which is under ban by the UN Security Council resolution since 2013, like the Taedong Credit Bank or the Taesung banks. These banks are banned by the UN Security Council resolution, but since they open, you know, like subsidiary companies,
front companies
mm-hmm. inside Chinese territory, then they're able to evade the pressure. And they even share the ownership of those companies with Chinese. Mm. So it'll be very difficult to track down and punish these companies.
And Malaysia was apparently a popular destination for these different
companies.
Right,
so if North Korea is going to sever the diplomatic tie with Malaysia, then it'll be a huge loss in terms of the financial transaction opportunities for North Korea.
So should we be expecting another provocation in the near future? I mean, after all, Kim Il-sung's birthday is next month.
Well, I'm not a big fan of tying political calendars or important events of North Korea to the timings or the format of missile or nuclear tests, because North Korea's goal is singular, which is to become de facto nuclear state, equipped with the capability to strike anywhere, anytime, with any type of nuclear weapons, sent by intercontinental missiles. So it is only natural of North Korea, in order to achieve this ultimate goal, to engage in very frequent, you know, experiments, nuclear and missile. So there happen to be some coincidental overlaps mm-hmm. of important, you know, political, you know, events or national days and the timing of North Korea.
You think they're all coincidences?
All coincidences, but I think the there is a probability for North Korean regime to conduct the ICBM test in celebration of April 15th, the day of the sun, the birthday of the eternal leader, eternal president of North Korea. Because this time, North Korea only used the Polaris II, the SLBM version of the intermediate range missile, and four SCUD-ER, extended range SCUD. So I think we can expect that next time it will conduct the missile test with a different type of missile that leaves us with ICBM type of missile.
Meanwhile, THAAD deployment is fast becoming a reality here, with the first components of the missile defense system arriving in South Korea this week. China has been stepping up measures of economic retaliation. Here's a look at the latest.
U.S. mobile launchers, the first parts of the THAAD system, arrived in Korea this week. Last month, Korea's defense ministry and Lotte Group finalized a land swap deal for the deployment of the anti-missile system, putting the placement into action.
한미 양국은 소파 부지 공유를 위한 협의를 실시하는 등 관련 절차에 따라서 금년 내에 사드 배치를 목표로 추진해 갈 계획입니다.
But the Chinese government has repeatedly opposed the decision.
中方反对美韩在韩国部署萨德反导系统，这个立场是坚定的、明确的。我们敦促有关方面停止部署进程，以免在错误的道路上越走越远。
Up until now, reported actions of retaliation from China appear to be heavily based on rumors, but the recent developments suggest otherwise. Lotte retail stores in China were subject to surprise inspections, leading to a suspension in operation for dozens. Not only that, Lotte boycott campaigns have also been taking place near the stores. Another measure is the sales ban on tour packages to Korea. Chinese authorities instructed local tour agencies to stop selling related products and also halt cruise stopovers in Korea. For travelers already in the country, visiting Lotte-related companies has been discouraged. Following these actions, Seoul is closely monitoring the developments, but it remains committed to installing the THAAD system at the earliest possible date.
중국에 진출한 우리 기업이 정당한 대우를 받을 수 있도록 다각적인 방안을 마련하고 필요한 대응을 해 나가고 있습니다.
Industries related to China are on edge about the possible ramifications they may face from additional retaliatory measures. We look at how to find a way out of this deadlock.
These retaliatory measures from China seem to be growing in strength and scope. What's your view on them?
It is very serious. They expelled Korean missionaries from China, and they denied the visa applications of K-pop stars and Korean musicians who want to enter in China. And they also canceled the exhibition, which was prepared on the occasion of 25th anniversary of the normalization, diplomatic normalization between two countries. And then very recently, they banned travel for the Chinese people. So they asked the travel agencies stop selling package travel to Chinese people. And then how about the Lotte? They signed the land swap deal with the Ministry of Defense last February 28th. After that, they imposed the suspension orders on the Lotte Mart. Another thing which I really concerned about maybe the possible measures taken by the Chinese government is swap, currency swap deal. Mm-hmm. We have at the moment $120 billion swap deal. But out of 120, as of today, about $84 billion swap has been completed. Out of this one, $53 billion, the currency swap deal should be made with China. Mm-hmm. So if Chinese government boycott or stop swap deal with Korea, it can be one of the huge direct threats against Korean financial market. Mm. So this is really, as an economist, I'm really concerned about this one. Of course, even officially they deny that the government, are involving in this kind of retaliatory action, but we can guess easily who are behind those kind of retaliatory actions. So anyway, the situation is going to be very more serious for the time being.
But if this continues, China has a lot to lose too, no? The
Definitely.
Two economies are quite interdependent.
Right. Although China is number two economy in the world in terms of size, but South Korea is also a major player in world economy in terms of its international trade. And the mutual interdependence is of quite significant. Last year, in the year 2016, the Korea's export to China exceeded 144 trillion won. And Chinese export to South Korea is almost the same amount, $90 billion. So if the economic situation continues to get deteriorated, not only South Korean companies and consumers will suffer, but there will be a great deal of damage also levied upon Chinese consumers and companies.
Yeah.
The concern is that security matters should be settled by security, you know, in the realm of security and diplomatic means. But there should not be any spillover from one area, the security area, to the area of economic affairs and bilateral trade.
Yeah. It doesn't take long for us to find something that's made in China on us, around us, right?
Can I add one thing?
Sure.
Well, in fact, I buy the Dr. Bong's idea, thoughts. From the other point of view, in fact, out of total Korean exports, Chinese exports toward Chinese exports takes about the 26%. And then out of total incomes from, exports made by Chinese economy, it's only about 4%. For Korean economy, China has been number one trading partner. For the Chinese economy, Korea has been number four, the trading partner. But in terms of size, there are big, big differences. So practically speaking, we don't have many things to do to change Chinese policy toward Korea. Some economists empathize that because the intermediate products made by Korean companies have been main exporting items to Chinese counterpart. So when you stop our exports to those kind of items, it can be a fatal blow against Chinese economy. But as I said before, in terms of the ratio contribution to Chinese economy and to Korean economy, the Korean contribution to the Chinese economy is very limited. Secondly, when on the part of LG and Samsung, who are main producers of those items of products, intermediate products such as display products and monitors, something like that. Considering the current situation LG and Samsung have, they cannot stop exporting. So practically speaking, the fact is we don't have many things to use to change the government's stance.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but apparently young Chinese consumers are not really on board with Beijing's position. They say a product is a product.
Products is a product. Yeah. Chinese young generations are not so different from young generations in other countries in terms of separating their consumption choices and behavior from their allegiance to the nation. But all generations are more susceptible to call for patriotism, like in South Korea. So I don't think young consumers in China will be following the government's direction. But you made a very important point that the stamina of the South Korean economy is not so strong to endure even very short-term lapse, short-term crisis. So even slight dent in the continuous bilateral economic partnership, the South Korea economy, given the fact that it's already in a very strenuous condition that we have discussed many times in the recent period. This is a source of concern.
Yeah. Now, China, we know, has openly expressed concern about Trump's protectionism. But records show Beijing regularly employs these tactics as a tool of protest, not just with Korea, but with other countries.
Yes, China has been quite notorious. In the international community because they do not separate the political issues from the economic issues.
Yeah, it thinks it's economics.
President Xi Jinping promised that China will lead the free trade at the Davos. I trusted him.
We were very surprised to hear a speech at Davos because the USA has been strong supporters for free trade. And China has been criticized as one of the violators of the international customs and rules in terms of free trade. But over there, totally different roles they had. But in fact, when we review what Chinese government has taken, we can get the answer to that question. When Dalai Lama pays a visit to France and the Mongolia, they took the retaliatory action by using their trade policies. Mm. Actually, in this context, we can understand the Chinese measures, retaliatory actions against Lotte and Korean industries this time. So Chinese government has been very notorious.
Mm. One thing I'd like to highlight is that now Chinese government is having the National People's Congress and the Chinese People's Political Consultative Conference at the same
sessions.
Two sessions.
Mm-hmm.
And Li Keqiang, the Premier of China, announced that the target annual economic growth rate is 6.5 or slightly above, which many economists doubt easily achievable.
Mm.
Then Chinese government must be really mindful what kind of reverberation, negative reverberation will be generated by taking retaliations against South Korea because of the security matter, not even economic matters, but security matters. Then if Chinese economy will not be benefiting from the free trade regime in international economy, then Chinese government may be just shooting at its own foot.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, this time they has taken very retaliatory measures against Korea, not USA.
Right.
One thing we have to know is, when you look at the Chinese government decision, they always choose the easier target.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So we have to work, cooperate with the United States. Well, in terms of the third deployment issue, well, that's not only for us, there's only, as well for USA as well. So we have to work together with the United States. Then maybe that can be one of the ways for us to change Chinese government stance policy toward us.
Mm-hmm.
But I doubt whether right now Korean government is right now making efforts to step up those kind of cooperative relations with the United States.
Well, I was going to ask you this anyway, but this conflict over THAAD is essentially a clash of interest between the U.S. and China, and Seoul is just
South
stuck
Korea
in the middle.
South Korea is in the middle.
Yeah. Is there a way out?
Well, if you are in the middle, you can just shift a little to either side, right? If that's an escape that you are talking about. But as Professor Jim mentions, then being in the middle is not always a bad thing, meaning that you have two options available to you, right? You are not deadlocked. You have two directions to choose from.
Mm.
So if you do not like the pressure coming from one side, then you can always shift your position closer to the other side.
Switch sides?
Right, switching side, right?
Mm.
Keeping the balance. But the reason why Chinese government seems to be so obsessed with this issue, THAAD deployment in South Korea, is a political and personal one, because it is a matter of protecting the supreme authority of President Xi Jinping, not just in terms of the structural balance of power between United States and China, the nuclear deterrence, but it is also hinged upon the dignity and authority of Xi Jinping presidency, because President Xi Jinping himself reiterated a very stern opposition and warning against the introduction of U.S. THAAD inside South Korea three times, officially and openly. So any sign of weakness or soft position on this issue is Chinese government officials are afraid will be accepted as a diminution of the authority of President Xi Jinping.
Especially since the two sessions are currently underway.
Right.
In
Premier
China.
Li Keqiang, in his delivery of the report about the government performance last year, used the term Xi Jinping-centered government, or government centered on the leadership of Xi Jinping, six times. So anything that will harm or then may undercut the authority and the supremacy of Xi Jinping presidency should be prevented.
Mm-hmm.
And the THAAD issue has emerged coincidentally as one of the issues to be sternly dealt with.
So it looks like THAAD is going to happen. How long do you expect China to keep up with this?
Well, for the time being, there must be retaliatory measures from China. So the question then, how we can overcome the economic difficulties caused by the Chinese retaliatory action. At the moment, I'm very sorry to say that one, but we don't have many options available at the moment. But we have to use this opportunity to change our economic structure. We have to diversify our markets, particularly relatively the contribution of the Southeast Asian market in our Korean exports has been relatively very small. So we have to pioneer new markets, including Southeast Asian countries and Middle East countries. On the short-term basis, I think that we have to strengthen the some cooperative relations with the United States to persuade the Chinese government. And secondly, which is really concerned, I'm really concerned about, is that Chinese government just tried to use mass media to change the Chinese people's feeling, perception about Korea. I think once they change the Chinese people's thoughts about Korean people, I think it will be very difficult for us to change it and return to the previous situation. I think the government should have to at least contact with Chinese government to prevent them from using mass media to change the ordinary Chinese people and Chinese, particularly young generation Chinese people.
Mm. Mm. So some people are saying that to settle this matter once and for all, to get it over with, yeah. Seoul should just hurry up with the THAAD deployment. What do you think?
Well, I do not necessarily agree with precipitating the whole process of deploying THAAD, because there will be some technical issues to be, you know, correctly dealt with. But it's a matter of your national security and survival. So from the beginning, South Korean government should have maintained very persistent position vis-a-vis China and the United States, right. And in the context of domestic politics. This is national security matter. It is not as grave a security decision as saying a total transformation of U.S.-Korea security alliance. It is only introducing one battery, mm-hmm. one battery of U.S. forces, which will cover the radius of 200 kilometers from potentially incoming missile attacks from North Korea. Why should it be outgrown the very purpose, which is very specific purpose of introduction of THAAD? The issue has been way exceedingly politicized domestically and in terms of diplomatic relations with China. Mm. So security issues should be dealt by the rationales of the security and the strategic calculation.
We should send you to China.
Me?
yes, as our spokesperson.
But I don't think the Chinese government will issue a visa.
Oh, that could be another problem. All right, let's wrap it up here. Any last words?
Well, China is one of G2 member countries in the world. G2 means what? Two leading countries in the world. So I really ask the Chinese political leaders to take one more, or I mean, think one more time to take some actions, because China is different from China was.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's what I'm saying to Chinese politicians.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Wong?
I'd like to highlight that North Korean military threat is far more than just nuclear weapons and missiles. As illustrated by the assassination of Kim Jong-nam, North Korea also has a formidable storage of chemical weapons, and it has the fifth largest standing army. So we have to broaden our focus of discussion on national security. It should be more than just whether you agree or disagree with the introduction of THAAD. Mm-hmm. Because even if the THAAD system is introduced and is going to perfectly operating, you still have a lot of issues to be dealt with when it comes down to grave and present threats from North Korea.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to scare everyone in South Korea, but the discussion on national security should be more than just talking about that.
Mm. Right, well, thank you too very much for sharing your thoughts with us today.
Thank you.
And that's all for this edition of News Inside. Thanks for watching. We'll be back with more next week.